lost another one. Hey everybody. Welcome everyone to Saki Speakeasy Podcast, where I speak easily on various topics that cross my mind throughout the day. I'm your host, Saki Speaks, and I appreciate you giving me your most precious commodity, your time. You could be anywhere else right now, but you're here, sipping in the Speakeasy with me. All right, so tonight we are finishing up A Deeper Love Inside, with chapters 49, 50, and 51, as well as the after story. So before we get into that, a little housekeeping. You guys, please show some virtual love to my moderators, Evil Lynn, Love Jones, I See You Are a Family, and Bikini Body Challenge. They work hard to keep us safe in the speakeasy, so please show them some virtual love. Thank you. Please make sure that you wipe your feet, which is the equivalent of applying pressure to that like button, subscribing to my channel if you haven't already, hitting the notification bell and selecting all, leaving a comment, and sharing my channel on your social media. Also, subscribing to me on Instagram and Twitter at Saki's Speakeasy. All right. And you can also tip your content creator at $SakiSpeaks on Cash App. All right, let me see who is joining us. Let's see. Hang on, let me scroll all the way back to the top. All right, first up, opening up the Speakeasy. Baby, she beat me here. Mother is in the building. Welcome, Black Diamond. Thank you, Mother, for being here. I appreciate you. Welcome, welcome. All right, you guys, please support the channels of the Black women listed here. We are supporting Black women over here, so please subscribe to those channels. You're sure to find something that you like. Hey, Bikini Body, that's one of my super snipers, the little sneaky laughing one. Subscribe to her channel. She's got a waist trainer and ab workout challenge happening now. So get over there so you can take your lowercase u to a lowercase v. If you got a capital U, you may just end up with a lowercase u. But either way, get over there, child. She got some other workouts too. Go ahead and get your sweat on so you could be looking sexy this summer. Hey, Dana Wayna, welcome back, darling. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. Welcome, welcome. Hey, Jack the Voice, good to see you around these parts. Welcome, darling. Thank you for being here. I appreciate you. Hey, Evil Lynn, that's my super sniper in the ghillie suit up there. Welcome, darling. She's got the trucking and cussing channel over there. Matter of fact, she's driving while moderating. We multi-talented, multifaceted, and we be multitasking over here. Thank you for being here, darling. I appreciate you. Hey, family. Welcome, darling. Thank you for being here. I appreciate you. That's my Irish twin sniper right there. Welcome, welcome. Got some good time pieces over there on that channel, as well as some beauty and braiding happening. So get over there and check that channel out. Let me see. Who else is here? I think I got everybody. All right, let me see. I think that is it. Yes, please, please, please. Thank you, thank you, thank you. All right. Okay, I don't think I missed anybody. So let's get started. And to those of you that are in the clouds and the shrubbery, please make sure you smash that like button. Hey, Tracy Cakes, welcome, darling. Thank you for being here. You slid in right before I got started. Somehow that just came out Jesus. But you knew what I meant, child. Oh my God. All right. Chapter 49. After a night of intense feelings and tender kisses and arousing tongues touching, I still awaken with my pussy pounding. I squeeze my thighs together tightly, trying to soothe it or slow it down. Elijah was asleep. He looked like he was deep in it and like he surely needed it. I resisted a so strong urge to mess with him so that he would mess with me. Instead, I touched myself, then pulled back my fingers. So this is the scent of him inside of me with a little bit of blood mixed in it, I thought. I slid down and out of his single bed. Both naked, our clothes were everywhere. As I tiptoed into his bathroom, I said to myself, the red dress should only be worn once. That's the beauty, power, and influence of it. After showering, I wrapped myself in a big blue bath towel he had. I eased the chair from beneath his door and unlocked, then turned the knob. The house was completely quiet. Tiptoeing down the hall, I stopped in front of Sheba's door and tapped lightly with my fingernails. I couldn't hear her moving. Figuring she was still sleeping, I turned to go back. Her door opened. I looked, and her face appeared. Sheba, can I borrow an outfit? I asked her. She opened her door some more. Then I stepped inside. She closed it behind me. You really are something, she said. What do you mean? I asked her. So bold. You come in here and fuck my brother, sleep over, and walk through the halls naked. Elijah fucked me, I said. It was our first time, and it was really so nice. My feelings are still going crazy on the inside, I said to her. Her mouth was dropped open. I didn't know why. I was being honest with her. I'm not naked. I'm wearing the towel. I heard you through the walls, she said. So then you must understand, I said. Don't you have a boyfriend? I asked her. Yes, she said. So you definitely understand. I've been in love with your brother since I was 11. Now I'm 16. We both really try to manage. How is it for you and your man? You two must be managing better than Elijah and me, 'cause you don't have any babies, right? I asked her. There is something called birth control, she said with soft sarcasm. I know, but I don't like medicine or doctors. So you two didn't use nothing? She asked. No, and it felt so good. Sheba threw her hands up. Where have you been all of this time? And what did you do to my brother Elijah? I was working. And what happened to your brother? You know what happened. You put some kind of spell on him that made him love you too much without you even being here. What did you write in your letters to him? Sheba asked. I knew she was referring to the letters I wrote to Elijah every other day for 2 years. The day after my disappearance from Brooklyn, I wrote and mailed the first one to him from upstate New York, along with my diary, which I dug up from the ground at Nana Anna's. Even though I had scratched out everybody's name except my own, he would still get to know and feel my true story. I had written to Elijah for many reasons, because I wanted him to know for sure that my leaving was not because I didn't love him. I gave him my diary because I trusted him and wanted him to know me, really know me, what I had lived through and why my mood swings so hard. I wanted him to understand that I needed time to separate from him, but not forever. I needed help with those holes in my heart. Why didn't you just ask Elijah what I wrote? So clever. You enchanting one, Sheba said. I didn't know what enchanting meant, but I marked it in my mind to ask Elijah later. Elijah kept your letters in a trunk, locked in his closet. Every time he received one, he'd go in his room, close the door, and not come out. None of us knew what you were telling him. Whatever it was, it must have been so magical that it changed him, she said. In a bad way, I asked. No, in a different way, she said, avoiding filling me in. Sheba, I have my own clothes, of course, but not here. Can I just borrow a pair of jeans and a tee so I can run to the organic market? I want to make breakfast, I said. So now you're going to cook in my mother's kitchen? Sheba asked. I'll cook for your mom and for you, too. Wearing Sheba's jeans and a Bernard t-shirt, Sheba's socks, and my red high-top Converses, I prepared a fresh, should be delicious, all organic ingredients, including all seasonings meal. I grilled fish with onions and hot peppers. I made salad and vegetable soup, as Elijah would say, to give options. I made pancakes with maple syrup and organic strawberries. I didn't have the time to soak and boil down beans to go with the pancakes. I compromised and served a side of turkey bacon inside of separate decorated dishes nicely placed on the long Emmanuel table. Pecans, raisins, sliced bananas, cheese, and olives. Oh, child, listen. Osha, the healer, was the closest to a true mother to me. Or maybe I should say she was the closest to a true mother feeling. She had taught me well when I was 10 by teaching me how to teach myself. When I returned to her alone at age 14, exhausted and distraught, she welcomed me back in, thankfully. Food is natural medicine. If you want to heal, you must first heal with food. She taught me that healthy foods could even change people's attitudes and personalities and soften, then open their hearts. I was trying to soften and open Elijah's family's hearts to me. I knew that trust is feelings and actions stretched out over time. I also knew that with his family, because I had suddenly disappeared, I was just getting started again. Papa Jamin was the first awake. He followed the scent directly to the table. Good morning, Papa, I said to him softly. Sheba shot him a look. He nodded, pulled out a chair at the head of the table, and then sat down. I watched his eyes surveying. He was a big man. When I asked Sheba what was his favorite food, she said fish. He especially likes porgies because he catches them when he goes fishing from time to time. Sheba was difficult, but helpful. Good morning, I said when Mother Elon came in, wrapped in a pretty robe. She cooked it. I watched her. Was all Sheba said, her eyes widening some. Are you proud that she cooked and you watched instead of helping her? Papa Jamin said, or asked his daughter. Sit down, Papa said to his wife. It smells good, he commented. Azaziah showed up willing, eager, and excited. Man, it's been a long time since we had a homemade spread like this. He sat down, ready to get to it. Go and wake up your brother. Tell him to come down here, the father said. Azaziah got up, and we all gonna eat at one time, Azaziah commented as he left. No one's smile was brighter than Elijah's, but he wasn't the one I needed to convince. His heart was already open to me. You stayed asleep so long, we slipped out and went to the market. She cooked all of this. Weren't you worried she might disappear again, Sheba asked. No, Elijah said confidently. She accepted my wedding ring. And I loved her right last night. If she left me after that, it would mean that I love her, but she isn't the right one for me. With all eyes on my three diamond rings, I kept my head down and spilled a few tears. I had felt the warmth and the warning in Elijah's words. A warning to me, a warning to them, a warning to us not to take his love for granted. I understood. Mama Elon said some words over the food as they cautiously began eating. I peeked and thought I saw their hearts soften. All right, let me get a sip of coffee, y'all. Hold on. Okay, yeah, she doesn't have a filter at all. Okay. Yes, homemade vegetable soup is good. All right. Elijah, I gotta get my clothes, I said, returning back to his bedroom after learning how to use their dishwasher and choosing to wash the dishes by hand instead. You good? He asked. I'm good, was all I said. His eyes were staring into me, beyond my body and into my feelings. You left your bed sheet in the hallway, I told him, also noticing now that his mattress was bare. I know, was all he said. Let me wash it for you. I turned to go and get it. Just leave it there. Are you on your period? He asked me strangely. No, I smiled. How come you asked me that? Instinctively, I pulled the tea and placed my nose inside and inhaled. He smiled at me for being insecure. Let's go. Thanks for cooking our breakfast. No one could front on that. I was stupidly prepared to ride the bus or catch the train, but Elijah's driver pulled around in a Crown Vic. He opened the door for me. I got in. Where are we headed? The Four Seasons Hotel in the city. We'll get your things and check out of there, he said. Okay, I agreed. You look pretty, he said. In Sheba's clothes, I asked. In anything, he said. What room are you in? Suite 1111. I requested that room. That number. When I first checked in, they said that suite wasn't ready. I sat in the lobby 3 hours waiting for it. That's crazy, he said. Elijah, you don't ride the bus no more? I asked him. Of course, but these drivers are on call and as directed all week because of the film premiere. They'll drive us down to DC tonight, he said casually. Washington, DC? Yeah, I got a gig at Howard University. Sheba graduated from there. Some students will watch the flick after dinner tonight, and me and my band will play at their after party. Excuse me. You got a whole band now? I asked him. Oh, God, what's with my throat? One second, you guys. Okay, forgive me, you guys. I had to get my throat together. Hey, Mimi. Welcome, darling. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. And thank you for listening in the background while you're at work. All right. Thank you, guys, for your patience. All right. You got a whole band now? I asked him. You know I gotta play my music, but I'm not taking you to the party, he said, like it wasn't nothing. I didn't say anything, but I felt a little sad that I wasn't invited. I'm taking Siri. Maybe she'll sing something if I strum the strings right. It's up to her, I said. Elijah, when we get to the hotel, can you give me 15 minutes to clean my room before you come in? Definitely not, he said. You know me. I want to see how you was living. My man, the valet said when the driver opened our car door and Elijah stepped out. Then the fellows that usually sweat me every morning, watching my hips sway, were now sweating Elijah. I checked your flick last night on Church at Flatbush at the Kenmore. How was it? Elijah said. Place was packed. You got the whole Brooklyn behind you. Elijah, I'll be back. I took the opportunity to run through the hotel doors and straight to the elevator. I was going to try and fix up my room. Upstairs, as I fumbled through my red epi leather bag, looking for my wallet, which contained my room key, I broke a little sweat in the air-conditioned corridor. My bag was red, my wallet is red, my Converses are red, and the red do not disturb sign was glaring just as I left it days ago. I found the key. Dropping everything, I ran to the back bedroom and gathered up my Victoria's Secrets, which I had in every color, flung everywhere. I pulled out my empty Louis Vuitton luggage, opened it, and began assembling my lingerie inside. In the bathroom, I began collecting all of my carefully selected personal items. I never used the ones the hotels all around the world supplied. As I rushed around, I caught a glimpse of myself in the mirror. "Why are you panicking now?" I asked myself aloud. But I didn't know the answer. I put all of the lotions, oils, and creams in my leather waterproof case and put the case inside of my saddlebag. A thought shot through my mind. I ran to the vault. I typed in 0726, my birthday, and the vault door swung open. The program for Mama's wake was the first thing I saw. My eyes moved over Mama's photo. I stood stuck for some seconds. "Come on," Siri said. Then I collected the remaining stack of papers from the vault, including my passport, which listed me as Onata Rivers, my driver's permit that listed me as Penelope Sharp, my vehicle registration and insurance papers, which listed Mr. Sharp's name and Penelope's, my release and discharge papers from Kennedy Claus Hospital, my New York State identification card, and my Social Security card, all brand new, all listing me as Porsche Santiaga. I also had my Lufthansa airline ticket stubs, postcards, flyers, and advertisement cards written in foreign languages inviting guests to see my solo performances. I had one envelope containing the last letter that I had written to Elijah but never mailed after receiving the news of Mama's death. I pulled it all out, then realized I left the handbag I carried today back in the living room. I wanted to run and get it, but decided I better breathe before I collapsed in the closet where I was standing next to the vault. I inhaled, exhaled, and exhaled. Siri said, "You're panicking because this is the part where Elijah mixes with all the other parts of our lives. But, Portia, you should know by now, Elijah loves us. Everything is okay. It's better than okay. It's good. It's perfect," she said, and her voice was sweet and calming. When I stepped out of the closet, Elijah was standing there in my bedroom where I had been staying for 3 weeks now. "I'll get you a house cleaner," Elijah said, smiling. "What kind of hurricane happened in here?" he joked. "I asked you to give me 15 minutes," I said. "You needed 15 hours," he said calmly. "Don't call housekeeping, please. I don't want them touching my stuff." "They already told me you're stuck up," Elijah said, teasing. "I'm not," I said. "They said you don't talk to anybody. You always keep your do not disturb sign on. You make them leave your room service food outside your door, but you don't eat it anyway. They said you don't get no visitors, but you talk to yourself while you're walking through the lobby." I just looked at Elijah, my hands clutching my papers. "I like that," Elijah said. "Like what?" I asked. "What would I have done if they said something different about you? Probably gotten into a brawl, got sued. You know people want to get knocked out by a celebrity. Every punch is worth at least $10,000. Finally, I smiled. "I like the idea of Elijah knocking somebody out to defend me. That's not all. My man, the valet, said you push a mean, rimmed out black 600 Benz with custom-made red leather interior and an AMG kit. The guy started to tell me how much it cost. I told him I know exactly how much it cost. It's Mama's car," I said softly. "But you bought it," he said seriously. "True," I confirmed. "What you got in your hands?" he asked. "Personal papers," I said. "Let me see them," he said. "Why, are you the police?" I asked. "No, I'm your man. Give in to me." Ooh, child, now give in to me. After we talked frighteningly, honestly, seated on the floor in the hotel bedroom for a couple of hours, our emotions were stirring. Telling all the truths I could tell was like vomiting, without the stinky stench and mess. As I sorted out each truth for Elijah, it made the same as me sorting out each truth for myself. He wiped my tears with his fingers. In a room piled high with brand new shoes and kicks, designer dresses and handbags, shoe boxes and shopping bags, we sat on the floor next to my scattered documents, which I nervously shared with him. He kissed me. My heart started speeding. We were touching and tonguing. Elijah. What, woman? You talk a lot. This morning, when I woke up, my pussy was pounding. I never felt that same kind of strong feeling before. It was so powerful, even though you were asleep and not even touching me, it made me feel crazy. He kissed me again. It's just going to keep getting stronger and stronger, he said, squeezing my nipples. I think I like you too much, I said softly. He raised Sheba's t-shirt over my head. You're supposed to, he said, unsnapping the clasp of my bra too easily. My full breast popped out, the nipples rising right before both of our eyes. I might be a little scared, I said honestly, as he pulled Sheba's jeans down from around my hips. Scared of what? He said as he stroked my pussy through the thin panty. I began breathing heavy. I didn't give an answer to his question. You can't front on that, he said, his lips pressed against my left ear as he pushed inside of me. Both naked, all over again, I felt myself falling and coming, falling further, coming more. I was drowning and afraid of the overwhelming feeling and my complete loss of control, but it was a feeling I wouldn't trade for any other feeling in the world. Feathers, sequins, masks, glasses, hats. What is all this? Elijah asked. We were finishing the last bit of packing, emptying the living room closets where my show outfits hung, nicely packed inside of dress bags, while the accessories were piled on a top shelf. Costumes, I told him. Costumes, he repeated, unzipping one hanger bag, revealing a dress a crafty native made for me from sterling silver and turquoise. That's an incredible design. You wore this? On stage, I said. It must have been heavy, he said. And it's see-through. You wore something underneath the dress, right? He asked. I couldn't lie to him. I didn't, but the turquoise parts cover all my private spaces. I can show you, I said. He stood, staring, maybe imagining. I told you I'm a dancer, I said so quietly, without an ounce of brag in it. Not a fucking stripper or a stuck-up ballerina, and no one touches me. I explained softly again, but I had already shared that word with him in many of my letters. He just never saw it up close and in person, like how he was seeing my costumes up close now. After now knowing my body more than he ever did before, and after just pulling himself from between my thighs and peeling himself off of my curves, I could see that he was also in deep. Put it on and show me your dance, he said. Nope, you don't want to see it, I said softly. I realized I had just offered to show him, but something suddenly told me that I shouldn't. No, you don't want to show me, he said. In the limo, just us two, followed by a caravan of hired cars and trucks, we were rolling to D.C., a 3-hour trip from New York in a fast ride. Elijah, what does enchanting mean? I asked him. Let me see, he was thinking. Having a magical influence over one or more people, he defined as I sat thinking about what Sheba was saying to me this morning. Use it in a sentence, I requested. Her pull on her man was so strong, people thought he was enchanted. I understand, I said. How about patriarchy? What does that mean? It means the man, husband, father, brother, or sons are the bosses of the house, or the men are the bosses of the hood, the state, the country. What he says rules, Elijah carefully explained. Use it in a sentence, I asked him. If a house and the community are set up right, there will always be a patriarchy, he said. We laughed. So, if a woman has enchanted her man, is he still the patriarch, I asked. Yep, was all he said. Prove it, I said. He paused at first, delighted by the test. A true patriarch doesn't have to keep saying, I'm the boss, I'm the boss. He lets the woman talk and cry, because that's what they do. If he loves his woman and his daughters too much, even an enchanting one, it doesn't take away from his power or position. He protects and provides for his women, handles the business, and makes them moan. We laugh. And gives them babies so they can have something to focus on instead of getting themselves into trouble. So, why was the girl yelling about patriarchy at NYU the other night? She's out of order, we laughed again. Someone needs to tell her that the earth, that's you, revolves around the sun. That's me. And that's the end of that chapter. Okay, Let me see if anybody came in or what y'all was saying. Hey, Nola Wola, welcome, darling. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. Welcome, welcome. All right, let me see. All right, I think everybody, yep, I got everybody. All right, give me one second, guys. Chapter 50. Since being locked up, I never had seen so many girls in one place, but these girls were not prisoners. They were relaxed and free. They were pretty, of every shade of skin and type and style of hair. They walked confidently. We were on the campus of Howard University, Sheba said. When I went to school here, there were 17 female students to every one male student, Sheba said. Talk about competition. She was guiding us around. It was me and the girls from Elijah's staff and film, which of course included Audrey. Usually, out here on the yard, on a Saturday night like tonight, the fraternities and sororities would be stepping. It's really a fun and amazing thing to see. Stepping, I asked, is that dance? You could definitely call it a kind of dance, she said, which made me curious. Sheba, did you dance? I asked. You have to be a member to step, she said. And yes, I stepped. I'm a Delta. A Delta? I asked. Delta Sigma Theta. It's a sisterhood, a sorority, she explained. How do you have any sisterhood with 17 women to every one man? Audrey asked. Sounds like a fucking fight. Shoulder to shoulder in a packed college hall, Elijah had 1,000 women and 170 men mesmerized by his rendition of a Carlos Santana joint. Showing off, he played two guitars in one performance, the acoustic and the electric. It didn't hurt that he was tall and handsome, and that whatever he did and wherever he went, everyone could see him shining. On his guitar, he was more than good. His fingers were comfortable and swift. His strumming moved many hearts, especially mine. As he stood in the darkened hall beneath the glowing spotlight, him and his band, I asked myself, are you ready to handle this man who every girl of every type seems to desire? I even was asking myself, what had I done to win his heart so solidly? What made you come back? A voice to the left asked me. I looked over my shoulder. It was Audrey. My mama died, so I had to come back to Brooklyn. I wish she would have lived, Audrey said, and I felt myself getting red real quick. I saw myself slapping the shit out of her. I saw the old Porsche stabbing her in her side or punching her dead in her face. But I didn't. I didn't like the slick shit she was saying. She wished Mama would have lived. I wish Mama would have lived too, but I knew that's not what she meant. And what if I beat Audrey's ass and then had to explain to Elijah or anyone that I beat her because she wished my mother would have lived? The twist of her tongue and words would have made me seem crazy. Instead, I turned to her and forced up a smile. Thanks for letting Elijah practice on you, I said. I could tell by the way he made love to me last night and this morning that he practiced on some bitch till I got home. Fuck you, Ivory, she said. I smiled again. That's the thing about being an understudy. Everyone feels cheated when the understudy performs. Everyone wants the real thing, I told her calmly. She pushed me. I pushed her back. She fell against Sheila. I went in my black Gucci bag, my fingers deciding on my box cutter or my bag of back the fuck up, which I always carried. Luckily for her, Sheba held her still. Sheba straightened Audrey out and walked her away from me. When I looked up, Elijah was watching me. I don't know what his eyes were saying right then, so we just stared at one another as he strummed out the finale of his session. I didn't take my eyes off of him. He didn't take his eyes off of me. Maybe that's what he wanted. Maybe he was hypnotizing me. I was willing. When he disappeared from the stage, the next group appeared. The crowd got a little restless while they set up. I felt a mixture of emotions. I felt the feeling you feel when you got beef with the next girl on lockup and everyone's moving in population. You must keep your eyes moving and watch all hands and mouths too. It was so easy for another girl to just stick you and keep walking. You wouldn't even know what happened until you saw your own blood bleeding. Then I also felt too pretty to get low, like a prisoner. I was wearing the dress that Elijah chose for my wardrobe, a black Christian Dior. I was standing high on my Giuseppe Zanotti heels. I didn't want to fight, but then again, I never did. But I would if I had to. An MC introduced what he was calling a go-go band. He wilded up the crowd and said, "This is how DC do it." I got excited seeing all the drums, really excited. They started tapping them. The music wiped away everything else. The drumming that began just grabbed me. What was it? Why did it sound so good? Why wasn't this music familiar to me? The beats jerked my joints and my body. My hips began to move and bounce. The beats wouldn't allow the body to flow. The way they were being banged out, the body had to shake. My hands and arms began dancing. My shoulders and breasts began vibrating. My butt and my thighs bounced. I bent my right leg and bounced it up in the air. I could make my thighs shake an inch open to the beat. Even my calves were excited. I felt so aroused, it was crazy. I couldn't fight the drum when a drummer touched it upright, and I never wanted to. A body pressed me from behind, and an arm went around my waist. I bounced on that body backwards. It took my hips all the way down to the floor and back up again. When I turned rhythmically, not losing one second or one beat, I saw what I knew. It was Elijah. I pressed in on him close, still making my whole body shake against his. When he danced with me, them DC girls caught the fever, but not all of them could catch those sexual magnetic beats with each groove of their bodies. The ones who could, the ones who obviously grew up hearing that go-go, pulled up on Elijah. He was dancing with me. I was dancing with him. They were dancing with us, showing him just how wild and open they could get. The dense crowd surrounded us, watching. The band was playing to us, and the crowd was chanting like crazy. The temperature in the room was rising so hot, even the walls were sweating. The only way I could stop was when Elijah carried me out of there. He did, leaving the go-go girl shaking and bouncing back there. I didn't fight him, of course. I just wrapped my arms around his neck and tried to slow down my pulsating body and racing heart. I would have kept going till the lights came on or to the last tap of the drum. Celebrity rule. We always arrive on the set after the party starts. We always leave the set before the party ends, Elijah said. We were all gathered in the reserved, roped-off area of the parking lot where our vehicles were parked. Elijah had his right arm around my neck, my body in front of his body, which was pressed against my back. He was speaking to his team. Many were faces that were not with him at NYU. Azaziah, Sheba, and Audrey walked up and joined in a minute late. "She is my wife," Elijah announced. "For the men, look at her once so you know, then don't look at her no more." They laughed some. Elijah didn't laugh. "For the ladies, treat her good. She's wearing my rings." "You must have fucked her. That's why she's mad," I said, with heated words spoken softly. "You have been gone 2 years. I never once accused you," he said. "And you're wrong. If I would have fucked Audrey, she wouldn't be so mad. She wouldn't say or do nothing. She'd just wait for me to fuck her again." That was the convo and the feeling on our way home Saturday night or Sunday morning around 2 a.m. His mother was standing over us. A dream, I figured, because I was naked, lying beneath Elijah, who was definitely naked. We were glued together by our now dried fluids, his strong sleeping body pressing me deep into the mattress. Through the fog of my sleepy mind and eyes, I became aware that my pussy was still pounding again. What a strong feeling our lovemaking had heaped on top of the deep feelings we already had for one another, and an argument. A disagreement didn't cause us not to love. It pushed us further inside of each other. I wrapped my arms around him, caressing. "Ivory," his mother said, but she wasn't really there. What would she be doing in Elijah's room while he and I were sleeping in a so intimate way? "Ivory," she said again, "get dressed and come out to the reading room. Don't keep me waiting long. I'm on my way to the service." I gasped for real. I gasped again. "Mama Elon," I said, tucked beneath her son, but she was already on her way out the bedroom door. Monday morning, Elijah married me. Mama Elon thought it was all too fast. She believed that we should have a big religious wedding. "Why not wait 4 months until you turn 18, Elijah?" his mother had asked him. Elijah confided in me that Mama Elon said 16 is the legal marrying age for women, but you still need my signature, she had warned Elijah. Pop will sign for me. He has already agreed to it, Elijah told his mom. He might not have mentioned it to you yet, but me and him talked it through thoroughly. He knows I will handle it. He knows it's what I need, Elijah had told her, but I don't want to do it that way. I want you to see my heart and understand and give in to me, he said to his mother. When Mama Elon summoned me to her family reading room on the second floor to speak woman to woman, I felt nervous. It's peculiar how it makes a girl feel in the presence of the mother of the man who has been feeling all over her body, especially when a girl knows that his mother knows for sure and that it's happening right under her nose and beneath her roof. Ivory, do you know the saddest thing in the world that a mother could ever feel? She asked me. I was fresh out the shower, the 3 to 5 minute kind of shower, and the only kind that could have awakened me that Sunday morning. Not exactly, I said, pulling at the hem of the skirt I had thrown on. My thighs were pressed close and tight, my calves one over the other, embarrassed and tense. It's when a mother loses her son or daughter. Loses, I repeated, loses him in any way to the world, to senseless violence, to racism, to illness or insanity. It's when a mother's child passes away at any age and leaves this earth before she does, she said sadly and serious-faced. I understood the words she was saying, but truthfully, I didn't get it. The second saddest thing for a mother is watching her son or daughter suffer, especially when there's nothing the mother can do to fix it. Like when I was seeing my son heartbroken, she said. I felt the accusation. Now I got it. Good mothers raise their sons and daughters well with continuous prayers that other mothers will do the same. This way, when my good son meets another mother's daughter, he will know to treat her with the utmost respect and to love her well. If the young lady has also been raised well, she will do the same towards my son. She will treat my son with respect. Mothers know that once a girl who our good son loves takes root in his heart, we can no longer protect him from the hurt of heartbreak. Mrs. Emmanuel, I respect and admire you, and I like you a lot. I know that you like me, too, although I am not sure how come. I know that Elijah is your good son and that he is way better than me, but I do love him strong and true. I don't think I could say that I was raised well, but I am sincere. My mother was a good mother, but sometimes even that has a time limit. My mother passed away 3 weeks ago. It was a pain so great in me, and it still is. I'm so grateful to Elijah because he is healing me from my hurt. Her face softened some when she heard of Mama's death. I was lightened to see that she had feelings enough to consider Mama. That made me like her some more. I know you saw how Elijah and I were this morning. I apologize for you seeing us. We didn't mean to show that to you. We were stupid and sloppy for doing it that way. Truthfully, when we finally saw one another starting on Friday afternoon, we both have been so happy. Friday night was our first time ever loving one another in that way, I confessed. Elijah wanted me to see the two of you in that way. He showed me the blood on his sheets for that very reason. He was creating a preponderance of evidence in your defense. My son is very much like myself. When he wants something, he wants it. He fights until he gets it, but he has never fought with me until this. Since there is no talking to him about you, I'll talk to you. Nothing is more important to me than my family, so you and I need to get on the same page, she said. I thought I saw her turning from Mama Elon into a prosecutor. I wanted to keep her in mama mode. I didn't think I could handle the prosecutor. So I said the things that I thought were the answers to all of the questions and thoughts that she might have for or about me. I wanted to say it before she asked, which would have been too much pressure for me. My father is a famous hustler doing life in prison. My sister is doing 15. Somehow, my two youngest sisters and I are all okay. I'm glad you invited me up to speak to you because I didn't want you to think that I deal in duplicity. I know you make good money, and you might think that I came back here for Elijah's money. But Mrs. Emmanuel, I returned to Brooklyn for my mama's funeral. Before that, I had been in Germany. I came to find Elijah because I love him and he loves me. I don't need his money at all, but I think it's so dope that he knows how to make it and that he made a movie like he always said he would. Would you sign a paper saying what you just said about not wanting his money? If you want me to, sure, I'll sign it. Even if Elijah didn't make a movie, I would still love him like crazy. You introduced me to your son when I was 11. Smiling, she said to me, I have two handsome good sons, so this house has been filled with plenty of pretty faces looking for the both of them. I chose you for Elijah because when I first looked at you, I saw that your heart was good. Somehow, your soul was glowing. After I chose you for Elijah, his heart chose you for himself. You and I should always work together, even separate from our men. You and I have to have some harmony. I am accustomed to having a very close, happy family, although I can't get any of them to go to temple with me. Temple, I repeated. We are Hebrew, she said. See, there are so many things that I should talk to you about. It's nice to see that you are humble and willing. I promise to make your son happy. I won't disappear. If I'm alive, I'll be right beside him. I can cook and I clean. I work really hard. I can't promise you anything about temple or religion. I don't even know what Hebrew means. What I know is I am already happier than I've ever been, I said softly. And I agree to the first and the second marriage ceremony, and I won't break Elijah's heart on purpose, ever, I swore. And Mama Elon, you don't know this yet, but my promise is as good as gold, I smiled sincerely. I wanted to be a good daughter-in-law to her, truly. I had every reason to love her. She was everything I ever wanted from my mama. She loved Elijah the way I wanted Mama to love me. I also thought that just maybe at our second private wedding ceremony in her church or temple or whatever, I would get to invite Midnight, Lexus, Mercedes, Riot, and maybe even Nana Anna somehow. I would send invites to Onata's whole family. They would definitely show up, including her brother, my drummer, and his wife. Maybe as a wedding gift, Riot would bring Lena to me and allow her. Or allow two of her puzzle pieces to attach themselves to one another for a change. I fantasized about having the diamond needles as my bridesmaids, all 11 of them, including Siri, of course. Lastly, but really importantly, there is the elegant Mr. Sharp, Big Johnny, Esmeralda, and my whole Who Over 40 crew. Mr. Sharp would outfit the entire event and place some of our photos on his wall at the Golden Needle. Ivory, Elijah's mom seemed to have raised her voice. You daydream, don't you? She asked me. Sometimes, I admitted. Do you have any idea whose car that is parked in my garage? It's mine, I told her. And that's the end of that chapter. Okay. Yeah, his mama needed to know. She got her own fucking money. She don't need Elijah money. Man, mamas know they be tripping. I can't be mad though, because listen. I'm not mad at Elijah's mama. I'm probably going to be the same way. I hope not, though, but probably will. Don't judge me. Judge your own mama. Chapter 51. As we left City Hall, Elijah, Mama Elon, Papa Jamin, Azaziah, Sheba, Mr. Sharp, and myself. We were met on the steps by at least 50 reporters who were joined by a swelling mob of fans. I can't say I was surprised. I saw the excited looks of the women working behind the counter when we first arrived and believed I saw the girl who phoned in the fact that Elijah Emanuel was in the building getting hitched. Elijah, have you seen this? A reporter asked, holding up the New York Daily News headline, which read, Elijah gets the gold. Excuse me. Nah. I was focused on getting the girl first, he said, smiling. He was still holding my hand. I was standing hidden behind him. Who is she? A reporter called out. My wife, Elijah shouted back, causing the reporters to laugh. Is there a prenup? A reporter asked. For what? I'm gonna love her forever, Elijah answered. The cameras were steady clicking. It's all hers anyway, he stated boldly to my disbelief. I wouldn't dare look back to see the expression on the faces of his family, our family, Mama Elon in particular. Although I understood the feeling Elijah was expressing of wanting to give the one you love everything you have and being more happy to see them have it than to have it to yourself. Maybe Elijah was feeling now what I was feeling on the cold winter evening when he placed my hands underneath his warm underarm. I felt the love swelling in me. I wanted to give him everything I had and anything he wanted. That feeling grew so strong that on Elijah's 14th birthday, I withdrew my $20,000 cash from Mr. Sharp's safe. It was the same money that I had worked my ass off to earn and save for Mama's apartment. I placed it neatly inside of a pretty box stuffed with pretty tissue paper and decorated with a pretty red ribbon. I gave it to Elijah along with a carrot cake I made from scratch with love for him. Both of these were my gifts to him. I wanted him to have his movie camera and realize his dream. My dream about Mama and us getting a new apartment together was looking impossible back then. Mama didn't want to live with me, it seemed. Filled with love for Elijah and sorrow for Mama after she removed all of my things, clothing, and belongings, except the cell phone Elijah had given me, I handed the gifts to him in the cold wind and asked him not to open them until he got home and was alone in his bedroom. It was $20,000 cash plus almost $100 for the organic ingredients for me to make the homemade carrot cake and then place it inside of a quality cake container. I never missed or regretted the money. $35 million on your opening weekend. What do you have to say to that? A reporter shouted. Show the people what they want to see, Elijah answered. What do they want to see? A woman shouted. A love supreme, Elijah smiled. And promoted. People applauded. Elijah agreed to convene in a nearby hotel for a roundtable for the high visibility press, which included the New York Times, the Wall Street Journal, New York Daily News, Associated Press, the Amsterdam News, Newsday, as well as The Source and Vibe magazine. $35 million, Elijah whispered to his mother as we entered the room where the press was gathered. Did you see the headlines? He asked her, leaning her way. I saw a write-up with that kind of prediction early yesterday morning in the Wall Street Journal, she whispered back. I offered to step to the side. Elijah, holding my hand, pulled me closer to his side and held me there. The Associated Press reporter asked, Elijah Emanuel, can you please confirm that your film is an independent film made without the backing of any major movie house? Confirmed, was all Elijah said, which caused the crowd to laugh. An older man from the New York Times asked the next question. Elijah, why is the film titled A Love Supreme? It's a salute to my father. He's a retired musician, a sacrifice he made for our family. Instead of pursuing an uncertain music career, he labored and earned and paid my mother's way through law school and raised a family. He always enjoys listening to all kinds of music, including John Coltrane, who had a track titled A Love Supreme. My father has been married to my mother for 25 years. He worked at UPS for 20 years. His life is like a jazz instrumental. Besides, the title of a successful film should welcome in the whole family, grandparents and all, each generation, Elijah explained. Was the film based on a true story? The Vibe magazine reporter asked. How did it feel? Elijah turned the question on him. There was nervous laughter. If it felt real, it was, Elijah said solemnly. About the movie soundtrack, the Source reporter asked, you have two cuts moving up the charts and heating up the top radio countdowns in every major urban area and moving with a bullet on Billboard Top 100. Will you pursue a music career in addition to film directing? And when will you showcase a live performance from Siri of her remake of Loving You entitled Elijah? I fidgeted. They were talking about my girl, Siri. Elijah gripped my hand more tighter. He was letting me know to trust him. I do trust him more than anyone else. Siri is a shy Brooklyn girl I know who sings from her soul beautifully. She doesn't want to be in show business, but she agreed to sing that song only for me. That's why it's retitled Elijah. I knew the whole world would want to hear her voice, so I recorded it. We're going to let it rock. If it hits number one, maybe she'll change her mind by popular demand, he said. How does your new wife feel about the new artist Siri singing so passionately to her husband? A woman from Newsday asked. Everyone laughed. My wife has known me since I was 12. She knows girls tend to like me, Elijah smiled brilliantly. The cameras were flashing. Elijah is a trip. Anyway, the Newsday reporter followed up. Where did you and your wife meet? Why such a young marriage? You are reported as being a 17-year-old high school senior, she asked. We met in an organic market in Brooklyn. I love her more than anything. She's my motivation, and a man should get what he wants and make it his own. A $35 million opening weekend. How will such a young man manage all of that money? The Wall Street Journal reporter asked. Oh, I'll manage, Elijah smiled again, bringing the group to laughter. Who is your attorney of record? The Wall Street Journal asked. My mother, Elijah said. Who is your management? They followed up. My mother. Everyone laughed. I think I can finally afford to pay her fees. When I get back in September, I'll retire her from Wall Street. What's next? You got the gold, the girl, and the fans obviously adore you, the Amsterdam news reporter asked. Honeymoon in Dubai, Elijah said. Sounds like a film title, the New York Times reporter blurted out. Dubai? I asked Elijah when we were alone. He pulled up a world map on his computer. I'll show you where it is. He pointed. You traveled over here. That's Europe. We're going over here. We'll meet your sisters and family out there, he said. That's why I chose it for us. I thought it would make you happy. When Elijah and I had our intimate discussion, seated on the floor of my hotel room Saturday afternoon, I told him that I still loved my twins, but that I had buried my true feelings for Papa and Winter at the same time as I had buried Mama. Elijah said a one-word response, no. What do you mean, no? I asked him. No, you can never bury them. They are your family, no matter what. And if you can bury them, that means that one day you could bury me. You loved them before, so love them now. Love them always. Real love never disappears. And that's the end of the book. Okay. So now there is the after story. Give me one second, guys. Okay. After story. Siri cried uncontrollably. Hers were silent, soft, warm tears. Portia, she whispered. She was standing in the corner of our bedroom in her yellow sheer nightie and gold slippers. You are only loving Elijah and little Elijah. You are forgetting about me. Because Siri cried, I cried too. Even though my life now is 93% peace and pure happiness. Woman, Elijah said. That's what he calls me when he doesn't know what to call me. We were lying in our huge bed beneath our Egyptian cotton sheets next to our wide wall-length window. The moonlight was incandescent, causing Elijah's beautiful dark brown skin to glow even more than it did naturally. Incandescent. A word Elijah taught me, among hundreds of words he had taught me, but this one I learned on the first night we moved in here. It is our new house, which he had promised me when I was 13, a house with great big windows, and since Elijah already came from a house filled with love, he saw no reason to actually separate from it. His wealth and popularity made many doors open to him. That, coupled with a large number of people making an exodus out of downtown Manhattan and Brooklyn, made it possible for him to buy the brownstone he grew up in, as well as two more on the opposite side of his backyard, one to the left and the other to the right of it. The three buildings represented his commitment to remain strong and loyal to his neighborhood, the people, and the businesses that knew and supported him, and to those facing trying times. The three brownstones, plus renovations and extensions, made up the Emmanuel's East Coast estate. Our newly born baby, nearly 6 months young, Elijah Jr., began fidgeting in his sleep, the same way his small body always reacts when he suddenly hears his father's voice after not hearing it for some hours. I placed one finger over my lips so Siri could see it and try and be quiet. I wanted Elijah Jr. to sleep some more while I sorted out my thoughts and feelings. Elijah pulled my body close to his. He placed his fingers on my face. Elijah is so comfortable with my tears. He had even told me that he fell in love with me because of the honesty of my tears on our first date. I still don't know the secret of why a woman's sincere tears move men. Now he was gently wiping my tears away with his tongue. Then he began kissing me. My body gave in to him as it always does. He was moving over me now, both of us enjoying the intense sexual feeling that takes over when both of us are trying to bump, grind, and love each other quietly as another person, Elijah Jr., lays on the same bed and still another, Siri, stood watching closely. It felt so good, our movement, and the passionate way that Elijah expressed his love to me. He was deep inside of me now, and deeper inside of the feeling. I am already pregnant with our second, and the sensitivity of the recently impregnated womb intensified the pleasure of each touch, push, and movement. Now, I was breaking my own rule to keep quiet. I was moaning, unable to hold in the sound of what our thrusting was making me feel. There was no one living in the next room or up close enough for me to hold back the sounds of our love. There was no reason for Elijah to place his thick fingers over my mouth and whisper, "Shh." My husband isn't a moaner, but his heavy breathing and way of coming for me and working up a slight sweat fucking thrilled me. I was excited by the way my hips moved, excited him. The way he gripped on to the headboard or mattress, mashing me even more, made me come harder, and I shook some. We were both moist and warm now. Elijah kissed my ear and rolled off. Like a magnet, my body turned towards his back and clung to him. I pushed my hands through his arms, my fingers resting on his ass. "Elijah," I whispered, kissing down his spine. I began caressing the back of his legs. "Elijah, we gotta get going," I said. "That's why you were crying," he said. I knew it wasn't a question. He knows me too well. He knew that I was shaken up because today is the day that he'll drive me to upstate New York to one of the many, many prisons to visit Winter Santiaga, my big sister, for my first time. Elijah owns his own business and sets his own work schedule. Even though he is his own boss, he is also, as he explained to me, the product. Therefore, he is most often very busy and in high demand. He could have ordered his driver to drive me and his security to accompany me. However, he handles all matters involving his wife personally and privately, attentively and compassionately. You say you want me to get up, but you're still touching me, which means we both want to stay right here in these sheets, Elijah said as he turned to face me. Soon as he started sucking on my breast, Elijah Jr. burst out of his sleep in protest. Elijah Jr. seemed to believe that my breast belonged only to him. Now our son was sucking from my right nipple and my husband's lips were locked around my left nipple. It felt good and confusing. My son's suckling makes me feel loved and needed in a really pure way. It was as though he was pulling life out of my breast and becoming more alive because of me. I felt a love for my son and from my son that seeped deep down in my bones and even circulated in my blood. My husband sucking on me was so erotic and excited, it made my pussy muscles contract wildly, which aroused me like crazy. 17 years young, I'm a wife and a mother. This whole feeling of having a loving husband, father to our son, made me wonder why every woman wouldn't want this exact life. Quietly, I decided that every woman does want the same feeling, things, and life, but most don't have the confidence to pull it off. Didn't know how to make it happen, couldn't seal the deal, so to speak. I do know for sure that love is completely different than business. Many women don't know how to be sweet, don't know how to love and be loved, don't know how or who to allow to love them. Don't know how to inspire their men to become great men. I almost fell into this same category. I am so happy that Elijah always had the type of love I admired, needed, and respect. That fighting love, the kind that doesn't give up or give in, especially when a man can feel that his girl loves him too, but just needs a little help and a little push to pull herself together, then merge. Elijah and I began playing a rhythm on Elijah Jr.'s back to get into birth. Our hand song made us both sleepy smile. Another thought came to me while holding our son. How could any mother not be in complete love with her children the way I am? Then, inside of 1 second, my 93% peace and true happiness shattered into pieces as I thought of my mama. Why didn't she love me? Why couldn't she love me enough? I knew now that drugs were mind-changing substances. Thinking about it further, I realized that more than altering a person's mind, drugs had the power to change and erase a person's heart. Is Siri around? Elijah asked me. She sure is, I told him honestly. Tell her to get under these sheets. I won't touch her, Elijah pleaded. Turn around. She's already in. She's lying on the other side of you. But why touch her while you have me here? I asked him. Then I put Elijah Jr. in the locker next to our bed. Siri is more freaky, he said. Siri, is that true? I asked her. I just do whatever I feel, Portia. You said I could spend some time with Elijah, but lately you've been hiding from me and keeping Elijah all to yourself. Only you have been having it all. I was facing both Elijah and Siri. Then she placed her pretty hand on Elijah's strong arm from behind him. She's saying that I'm greedy, Elijah, I said. He laughed. You are, he said, placing his fingers a little way inside of me. I feel it pounding still, he said, as his smile lit up the night. What does Siri do to you that makes you ask for her when I'm loving you? I asked. She sucks me here. He moved my fingers to his chest. She sucks me here. He moved my fingers to his thickness. It was rock hard again. And she sucks my toes, he said. Get out of here, I said, cracking up. She does not, I told him. I do, Siri said softly, and I like it a lot. And Elijah likes it too much. She says she does, I told Elijah, but there was no way I believed it. I told you, she's sweeter than you. I know you two are best friends, but you should compete with her a little, since you are here most of the time, and she only comes around every now and then. Of course, I knew Elijah had a deep and special feeling for Siri. I understand, because I have a deep and special feeling for Siri, too. She's soft and warm, pretty, calm, and wild at the same time. She is a comfort, and she always allowed Elijah whatever pleasures he could imagine. Sometimes, those two went further than Elijah and I would go, like the photo she showed Elijah to click of her naked and oiled body, sitting on the soundboard in his studio. Wearing nothing but Elijah's expensive, colorful guitar strap. He shot the photo from behind her, her beautiful back, small waist, and seductive spine pointing a path to her pretty butt cheeks. Her legs were cocked open, and in the other shots, she was naked and in pretty poses, which suggested she was making love to Elijah's guitar. I had told Siri she could sing for my man. The rest of the things that she did in his studio, those two got into all on their own. But I, Porsche L. Santiago, am the dancer, the movement specialist. I don't suck toes, but I do amazing things with my body, which keeps my husband constantly craving me. I know that's right. I was already stroking him. Soon as I began, he stopped talking. I hope Siri does all that sucking after a hot shower, I whispered. Uh-huh, he said quietly, so let's get in the shower. The three of us. We did. A mess. Nervous, my fingers were twitching slightly. Only Siri could see me shaking as we sat side by side on my divan facing the mirror. Elijah and I had separate bathrooms that were more like exclusive salons and separate dressing rooms as well. Moments after our erotic encounter in his shower that shot water from overhead, mid-waist, and up from the floor, I was seated in my pretty camisole and pants. It's funny in a sad way. When I am next to Elijah, I am so good. When he is not right next to me, I am not so good, but not bad either. When I tried to explain my feelings of love for him to him, all I could say is, you are everything. He asked me if I got that from an old song by the Stylistics. I told him I didn't. These were just the best words to describe my true feeling. His mom wanted me to know God, but so far, I only knew Elijah. She asked me if I had something I was grateful for. I told her I'm grateful for Elijah. If I close my eyes, I see him. When he's not there, I imagine. Give me 1 second, you guys. Thank you. I'm sorry, you guys. When I'm with him, I'm so open and joyful that I could easily explode. When I feel myself getting or going down, no matter where he is, he catches me. He never allows me to sink too low. He never goes too far from me or leaves me behind. He protects me, not just my body, but my feelings and my thoughts. He gave me the best things ever, his heart and our son. He also gave me back my twins by marrying me and building us a home that's so well constructed, safe, and credible that it made me good enough for Midnight to allow Mercedes and Lexus to come spend some weeks with us. With Elijah, I feel powerful. Without him, I feel vulnerable. Alone, I could earn, fight, and survive. With Elijah, I could live, love, and have peace. He attended to my heart and filled up the five holes, which no one else in the world was able to do. I wasn't sure if this was one of the things I needed to fix, but I was sure that I didn't want to fix this feeling. Do you know the meaning of Elijah's name? Mama Elon had once asked me. Elijah in Hebrew means God is salvation. Azaziah means strength. Sheba means oath. My name means oak tree, and my husband Jamin's name means right hand. I was remembering her words. We have these names for a reason, she said, trying to ease and pull me up to her standard. What about going to school? You're so young and you need a quality education, Mama Elon had said. Everyone going to school is trying to study so that they can get the things that I already have, I told her softly and respectfully and sincerely. What about a job? It would give you the feeling of accomplishment and success, Mama Elon pushed. I couldn't accept a salary job at this point, Mama Elon. I can still earn in entertainment in one night what it takes so many workers and even executives a year of full-time work to earn, I said. She made a thoughtful face, like she wanted to fight the point, but knew what I was saying was true. That's the way it is, Mama Elon, and I didn't set it up to work that way. You must understand me, right? I said it, and I meant it. Being Elijah's wife and Elijah Jr.'s mother is what I have and what I wanted most. It's what Elijah Sr. wanted also. I understood what Mama Elon was getting at, that when you have a talented mind or body, you should want to keep it alert and active by working on things and getting things done so you could feel good about yourself. The truth was, I had more than enough to think about and do. As Mr. Sharp taught me, I was making my money work for me. Sharp and I stayed father-daughter close. Through him, I was still flipping and investing the money I had earned before marriage. It's just that now I do it for sport. Before, I did it for survival, and mostly I did it for my mom. There were also my special things, like my new organic garden. I had to work hard to keep it nice, especially when the seasons changed. It made me feel so good when I cooked meals for our whole family with vegetables, fruits, and herbs that I planted, watered, and grew. My thoughts were tangled about whether or not I should wear my seven diamond bangles. These were sparkling jewels, the cleanest, clearest gems I had ever seen. Elijah had purchased them in Dubai on our honeymoon. He pushed and placed each one of them on my right wrist. They were so pretty, it was impossible for them not to raise jealousy in the bosom of any girl, the ones with jewels the same way as the ones without. I didn't want to raise jealousy in the heart of my big sister, Winter, I thought to myself, but I did want her to fully look at me and see me in the right way. I wanted her to feel that I had done well in life, even though I was the forgotten, invisible middle sister. I wanted her to see me and really believe in her heart that I was good enough, even by her incredibly high standards, that she measured fashion, friendship, popularity, and beauty when she was young and free. I wanted her to look at me with her 16 years young eyes, not the older incarcerated ones. I wanted her to choose me, to begin to write me some letters from prison and anticipate my replies. I wanted her to think that I was cool and to yearn to chill with me the same way I always wanted to be, holding her hand and following her around, believing that she was a queen above all other girls when I was 8. Back then, when I was deep asleep, I even dreamt of chilling with Winter without her trying to get away from me. Put them on, Elijah said, stepping up behind me. Dress up for me, he urged. As I saw the reflection of his smile spreading, my mind switched towards pleasing him. In a mean tailored black wool Burberry dress and black tights, rocking my seven diamond bangles and matching diamond earrings, I slipped into my black Burberry 3/4 length leather with the fur lining to repel the freeze. I picked up my black epi leather wallet, dropped it into my black epi leather bag, and stood staring for a minute, choosing between my black Manolo Blahniks or my Fendi riding boots. I chose the heels for Elijah. I took the boots along so I wouldn't bust my ass if snow began to fall. I pumped my Paloma Picasso perfume twice and walked out into the corridor, down the marble stairs, and into the foyer. In the foyer, I pressed the intercom button and said, "Morning, Mama Elon. Elijah is coming across with Elijah Jr. I pumped enough breast milk, and everything else you need is in the baby bag. Ivory, breathe and don't worry, not even a little bit," she said in her 4 a.m. sleepy voice. "I'll try," I said. "We'll see you tonight," I signed off. She knew Ivory was not my real name. She was the type who holds on tight to an idea, things, and even more so to the people she loves, really tight. So, since I first introduced myself to her as Ivory, she held on to it. I didn't mind. Elijah's mom had so many good things about her, it was easy to overlook our small differences and disagreements. She was patient with me. Very patient. In all things personal, she was sweet, sensitive, and supportive. It was only in conducting business that she was cold. In business mode, she was cold and calm and composed, even as she attacked. She was never a prosecutor in her real life, but give her some friction and she could flip into one like you've never seen or heard. When it came to money, she was mean. A smart and swift shark. I wasn't mad at her for that. She kept the money train moving and oversaw Elijah's biggest deals and dealings. She combed through his contracts with a fine-tooth comb, marking pages up with her red pen and deleting whole clauses that she said didn't belong. She became known for putting together unprecedented deals with perk packages so sweet they were worth almost as much as the check they had to cut just to be in business with the Emanuels. Elon Emanuel, Esquire, got Elijah endorsements as though he was a top-rated professional athlete. But he wasn't an athlete. He was the super young, super charming, super smart, 19-year-old movie director. Looking at the umbrella choices, rain hats, and accessories, I wondered if I could wear my black leather Gucci gloves. I held my hands up, checking out my manicure, each fingernail half black, half white, and precisely drawn without error. "Too pretty to cover up," Siri said softly. I pulled down the Gucci gloves and dropped them into my bag, just in case. Elijah was some minutes late. I knew he was saying a prayer, which he had said was completely new for him. Mama Elon was incredibly grateful that her son prayed now. She thought it was because of me. It wasn't. I believed it was because during our 3-week honeymoon in Dubai, he saw so many powerful, moneyed men bend their knees in prayer that he felt moved. Over here, the good guys and the bad guys, the poor and the rich, all bow down, Elijah had observed with his careful director's eyes, and it moved him. He told me that before our trip, he looked at temple as a place for women, and the bending of knees and lowering of the head as a sign of weakness in men. When we reached home safely, Papa, Jamin, Azaziah, and Elijah all surprised us by playing together one night. We women left them uninterrupted. I took it like I took anything with Elijah. He was full of surprises and unembarrassed about his love. When he loved, whether it was his God or wife or his family, who he confidently brought along with us on our honeymoon. The night of the Emmanuel's men's first prayer together became the start of their nightly prayers together. I turned to look back at our beautiful home. Two of our Brooklyn brownstones were connected by a bridge that Elijah designed. In our spacious backyard, which stretched over three lots, was a treehouse. Not something thrown together, but a badass treehouse embedded way up in the trees. It was like a private place for me and only those I invited. Yet, I never invited anyone except Riot and Elijah. I was so jealous of that fucking Indian in the treehouse, Elijah had once said to me. I wanted to correct him and say, not Indian, native. But I knew better. Why? He wasn't my man, I softly told Elijah. I don't care. Just the fact that he knew you, took care of you when you fell, and you danced for him made me crazy. He told you to grow up and come back to him, and you did. I didn't, I said truthfully. By the time I was 14, he was married. I didn't go back for him or because of him anyway. You know that. I wasn't never in love with him. I was in love with his drum and the beat. When you feel like running, run into our backyard. There's plenty of room. You want to live in the trees? Live in your treehouse that Elijah built for you. He smiled. But he was still fuming like it all happened yesterday. When you want to dance, dance in your studio, the one Elijah built for you. Move your hips for me, only for me, please. I felt him so sincere. As I had promised, I wanted to do whatever he wanted and to go wherever he went. So I moved these hips only for him and for myself when I'm alone. Maybe one day I would direct a dance studio for young, beautiful, angry girls like I used to be. A dance academy at Juvie would probably change everything and everybody for the better. I imagined even the warden, although I knew that there is nothing like living free alongside your family. Papa Jarman, Elijah's father, never said too much. I could see in his eyes that he understood why his son was enthralled with his enchanting young wife. That's what Sheba called me, enchanting. Mama Elon thought I was peculiar, a daughter-in-law who was strangely emotional, a daughter-in-law whose moods swing like a pendulum, a daughter-in-law who daydreams for hours and retreats into silence at times and cries and climbs and hides in a tall tree where the birds live. Despite her careful and continuous critique, Mama Elon and I had made our peace. Now, we lived comfortably in the day-to-day details of being the two women who loved Elijah the most, the two women who Elijah kept at his side by choice. What sealed our bond, really sealed it, was one of my rare panic attacks that occurred during our post-honeymoon travels. We were on a seriously tight schedule. All of us had accompanied Elijah on a college tour, which wrapped up at Harvard in Massachusetts. After Harvard, we were scheduled to fly into Los Angeles, California for a round of business talks with some executives that Mama Elon described as Hollywood's top brass. I had been feeling sick for the past few days of the tour. Mama Elon wanted me to see a doctor. Each day, I refused. She said she was pretty certain that I was pregnant. I agree with her, but still refused. She said I was being ridiculous, and that if I were in fact pregnant, I would have to see a doctor quite often. Is there a physician who you are more comfortable with? She questioned and pressed. None, I replied, as I sat feeling red, placing the word ridiculous onto a list of words that I hate and feel offended by. We both went to bed angry at one another. Before sunrise, I was sicker than I had been all week. I told Elijah I couldn't fly for 7 hours to California feeling the way I felt. When Elijah told his mom he was canceling our flights, she was so frustrated. The volume of her stern voice was propelled by the bedside speakerphone. Of course she feels sick. She's with child. Let her drink a ginger ale from the minibar. The feeling will pass. This is important business, and Elijah, you know what that means. Our itinerary is tight. If we push back one thing, it will delay and change everything else. And there's the serious matter of your going back to school. You've already missed too many days. She's my wife, and I love her, I heard Elijah say. We fly together, or not at all, he added. Then there was silence between them, mother and son. The plane we were all scheduled to take from Boston's Logan International Airport to Los Angeles, California, crashed into the World Trade Center and exploded that same morning. Me, Elijah, Papa Jarman, and Mama Elon all watched the flat screen in the living room of his parents' executive suite in complete shock and horror. It was my first time seeing Mama Elon's tears as she watched those who she was sure were some of her co-workers being driven out in all directions by heated clouds of fire and smoke. Many faces and bodies covered in ash. All business came to a standstill as lives became more important than money for the whole country for once. One second, you guys. Sorry, you guys. I have pernicious anemia and I forgot to take my B12 today. I almost thought I was about to pass out. My God. Okay. Okay. Sorry. Just give me one second. So I had to put the liquid under my tongue. I'm good. I just had to All right. Oh God. I was like, wait, what? Why am I rocking? All right. Okay. I'm good, you guys. I'm sorry. I just, y'all probably would have been shocked if I'd have passed out. Like, wait, what happened? Oh, man. And that would have been embarrassing. Oh, my God. I completely, and I kept saying, okay, I'm going to take it. I'm going to take it. I'm going to take it. Anyway. Sorry, you guys. All right. So I'm good now. After the Emanuels had returned to Brooklyn safely, and a few weeks after Elijah had donated money to the firefighters who graciously strive to contain the uncontainable, Mama Elon said to me, "That must be the reason why I saw your wings the first day I saw you in the organic market. There are not even words in the English language that I can use to express how grateful I am that you felt too uneasy to fly and that Elijah felt too uneasy to fly without you." 8.5 months later, Elijah Jr. was born without doctors and against Mama Elon's better medical judgment, but she yielded to her enchanting daughter-in-law because of the precarious circumstances. Instead, Elijah Jr. was born at home without the epidural drugs. There was only OSHA, aka Nana Anna, the only healer I would allow, and her two accompanying midwives. I didn't let them poke our son up with needles, unknown inoculations, diseases, or any strangeness. I knew too well how it feels to be too small to protest against being drugged. When I was young, because I was young, no one would listen to me or hear me when I said I don't want medicine or doctors. Still, our son was so healthy and happy, a peaceful baby boy who became the Emanuel family's love charm. Everyone was so taken with our son that even Elijah's grandparents moved into our estate. Sheba and her man decided to marry. Her man was so drawn to our baby that Sheba finally saw the light. She then realized that she didn't need another degree to have a baby and begin her family. Privately, I had mentioned to her during one of our polite but brutally honest exchanges that if she wouldn't give her man, her good man, what he wanted, the next woman would. After all, Sheba is my sister now. Why shouldn't I share with her some of the true things I learned? Thankfully, right before it was almost too late. Our son made Azaziah catch feelings and become more serious. He admired his younger brother even more once he became a husband and then a father. Instead of juggling and playing with a bunch of willing, silly girls, Azaziah began to narrow down his group of women in search of a true love and a woman he could respect and be comfortable enough to marry. As a family, we were all super close, but never overcrowded. In our spacious surroundings, we could all stay together and still enjoy one another. All of the alarms were shut off and then reset as we rode in reverse out of the long driveway and up to the iron gate. The remote caused it to open. I looked back at the gold plaque that was embossed with our family name, Emmanuel. We were leaving in Elijah's hunter green Range Rover, the house where we all lived, loved, and worked together. Although we traveled often, this was my favorite place to be. Winter, I said as I walked in and saw her. I hesitated, unsure if we were allowed to embrace. I glanced around. Other than the fact that there were at least 20 sets of eyes staring at me instead of their loved ones who they came to visit, I counted 10 guards, 20 tables where each inmate sat with a maximum of 3 visitors. Elijah had stayed back at the guest registration building. I wanted to come in alone because Winter and I are separated sisters with so many unspoken words and unexpressed feelings and probably even secrets between us. I thought bringing my husband would change something about the honesty between me and her. Winter and I are so separated, in fact, that we have now spent more time apart than we ever had living together back on our Bed-Stuy Brooklyn block and in our Long Island mansion. I knew we would even remain separated for 6 more years if Winter was required to serve out a full 15-year sentence. I saw someone else in here touching an inmate, so before sitting, I went and embraced my sister, my arms collapsing around her. Her body felt a bit stiff and restrained and had no particular scent, causing me to recall that captured feeling that makes a prisoner's muscles tighten so tensely that even peeing was hard work. Finally, I released her, pulled back, and walked quietly to my chair on the opposite side of her visitation table. Not looking me in my eyes, she stared at my manicure and said, "I heard you brought Elijah Emmanuel up here with you." I didn't answer back because I was thrown off a bit. Never thought that these would be the first words that we would exchange after over a 9-year stretch of being apart from one another, minus Mama's sorrowful burial. "My husband," I said softly. "Yeah, him," Winter said, stern and swiftly, as though she were quick and I was slow. "Who hurt you?" I asked, regarding the thin scar that ran down the side of my pretty sister's pretty face. "It's nothing," she said, "but I knew it was something." I could see that it was an old scar that she had come to accept without choice. I also knew that Riot knew an overseas surgeon who could lift that scar right off, like it was never there in the first place. I told myself, when my sister gets out, if she doesn't mind doctors like I do, I'll have it removed so she could feel good enough to look each person in their eyes when they were speaking to her, especially the one she knew loved her most, her family. "A couple of pictures with Elijah Emmanuel will go over big in here," she said. "I mean, business-wise," she added in a way as though she wanted to say she wasn't a fan. She was just a businesswoman, grabbing an opportunity and exploiting a celebrity. I put money on your books before I walked over here. You can live easily with that for at least a year or two. Get whatever you need, whatever you want," I said. She didn't respond. She didn't have to say thank you to me. That's not why I came up here and not why I gave it to her. I gave it because I understood what it is like to be in her position. I love her and wanted to help before she thought there was no good in the world, which is easy to think when you're locked down, in and up. "Have you visited Papa?" She broke the silence between us. "Not yet, but I will," I said. I didn't tell her that Elijah had been to see Papa a few times and had stacked money on his books without being noisy about it. I also didn't mention that Elijah was thinking about directing a film about our father, the infamous Ricky Santiaga. Elijah thought the true story of a real Brooklyn hustler could best be told realistically by someone on the inside. A Ricky Santiaga joint could be bigger than all the flicks from that genre. "Maybe we flip it around and tell it from the perspective of the hustler's daughter," Elijah suggested. "It wouldn't be all about guns, drugs, and betrayals, although that would definitely be a small part of it. It would be about a father, a brotherhood, and a network of families who set up, built, and ran an economy in a Brooklyn hood that nobody in power gave a fuck about," Elijah had once explained to me. "But look how it ended," I had said to Elijah, thinking and speaking as the hustler's daughter, or at least as one of them. He and I had often talked in detail about stories, true and made up ones. Yeah. Together, we read screenplays, wrote our own screenplay, and even watched films lying on our backs in our family film room. When we disagreed too much, it would end with a popcorn fight. We'd have fun making up while plucking kernels out of the plush carpet. Elijah, like his mom, would never give up on convincing someone, especially me, about his point. That's why I'll juxtapose Ricky Santiaga to another Brooklyn man. The two stories would give the audience some options before they draw any conclusions, he pushed. Juxtapose, I repeated. Now you're talking slick, Elijah, I complained. Juxtapose. It means to place two things, two stories, two people, side by side, to compare, he explained and defined. Oh, I said softly, I was thinking. In the back of my mind, I was admiring this married high school graduate who got accepted to Harvard, Howard, Stanford, Columbia, and NYU universities. I was told you had to be brilliant to do all that. All I knew was they accepted him. He rejected them, at least by delaying his decision for a year and privately letting me know that it was all up to me and that they needed him more than he needed them at the moment. Each of the colleges were in talks to get him to donate a wing, building, or fund, especially the schools that his family members had attended previously graduating. So, what did you come up here for? Winter interrupted my thoughts. It's been 9 years. You're my first visitor, besides some nosy ass reporter, but she definitely doesn't count. I came to see you, I said. For what? She pushed. I didn't know what kind of answer she was searching for. All I could give her was my true feelings, so you could see me too. We're family. It's not all right for me to have while you, I'm saying, we don't have mama anymore. You're our big sister, so it's like you're the mama now. I'm not nobody's mama, she said straight-faced, giving me a cold feeling. I am. I have a son, I said softly. Should I show you his photo? I asked. Later. Show me before you go, she said. And you should have been put money on Papa's book, she added. Elijah did. He even visits Papa, I revealed. That's what I'm talking about, she said a little excited. Papa must have told you. I know he writes you a lot of letters, I added. He might have mentioned it, she said casually, as though it was a small fact that could easily have been forgotten. You know we have a brother, I said suddenly. No, we don't, Winter said confidently. Yes, we do, I said softly, in almost a whisper. I wanted to talk about it, not challenge her. Our family is only the ones who grew up on the same block, same building, in the same apartment, and lived in the same house together, Winter said. Now I was quiet again. I knew what Winter didn't know, that Ricky Santiago Jr. has the same handsome face of our father, same hair, same eyes, and even the same jawline. The morning after Mama's burial, midnight had taken me to get my Social Security card and New York State ID and to handle all of the paperwork that gave me back my true identity. He had even given me a copy of my release papers issued from the Kennedy Claus Nut House, where the authorities lied and claimed I served out my time. After spending the whole day together and even enjoying a dinner, he took me to meet a lady who looked like a lady our father would be attracted to. Her name was Dulce Tristamente, and Ricky Santiago Jr. was her son and the son of our father. It was one of those things that didn't need to be questioned, denied, or tested. Blood recognizes blood. Would Winter be angry that I had feelings for the handsome young brother who handled himself like he was 12 instead of 8 years old? Was it wrong for me to give him my phone number and invite him to remain in touch if he didn't mind? Was it okay that I took his photo and even carried it in my wallet? His mother is a real bitch, Winter said, getting red. She was supposed to hand over some money that Papa had set aside for me, she fronted. She's first on my payback list. Just then, Winter looked like Mama to me. My mind juxtaposed the two of them, Mama and Winter. The memory brought tears to my eyes. What you crying for? This is not a crying place. In here, if you gotta do that, you gotta do it in the dark where nobody can see. She was serious. Okay, maybe the bitch is not first on my payback list, but she's definitely on it, Winter said. There's a few snitches and a few bitches that gotta get tagged back. I'm waiting for the day the real motherfuckers get released from all these upstate cells and put a spark to the phony motherfuckers that stepped into our spots when we got knocked and did a fucking horrible bootleg job of pretending to be us. You don't need a list. I'll be here on your release day. You'll have me and everything you need, I promised her softly and sincerely. A smile spread across Winter's face. Her smile caused me to smile some. I was relieved that family, I had said, no, yeah, I was relieved that finally, Jesus, I had said something right that moved my sister to feel good and to feel connected to me, her full blood relation. I had a dream that midnight was waiting for me early morning on my release day. He pushed a blacked out black Bentley, had it parked sideways in front of the prisoner release door. He was looking so rich and strong, the CO got tight that I had something to go home to. I was hyped because I knew he would run back and tell everyone how I'm living now. In the dream, when I got in his ride, all of the girls up here, I could hear them screaming and cheering for me through those thin little wired windows. Midnight took me straight to Fifth Avenue, bought me everything I chose. That dream was crazy, she smiled some more. Her face was still lovely, caramel kissed and slim, her chin dimpled. My heart sank some. I guess my offer to pick her up and take care of her for the rest of our lives wasn't popular enough. I don't push a Bentley. Elijah doesn't either. Mama Elon does. Have you seen him lately? Winter asked, snapping me back to reality. Seen who? I stalled, but I knew. Midnight, she said, excited. There were about 100 true things that I could have said about him and a few other topics, But I didn't want to. I wanted Winter to keep her dreams and her fantasies. I never wanted for my sister to be discovered hanging from a ceiling, her sheets twisted and wrapped around her neck. I didn't want her depressed, dead, and dangling until some authority cut her down, erased her from the count, threw her body in a pine box in an unmarked grave in an anonymous graveyard. I didn't want it to happen, and I never wanted to receive that call. So, there would be a whole bunch of true things that I wouldn't lie about, but I also wouldn't say. I would never tell Winter that Midnight is not thinking about her at all, and wouldn't have considered her even if she were not locked up. I wouldn't tell her that even if she flashed through Midnight's mind like lightning, she would be just as swiftly forgotten. I couldn't tell her that Midnight is rich, international, so fucking handsome and cool that. And that with the passing of time, he only gets better. I wouldn't tell her that Elijah went cruising on Midnight's yacht. I definitely wouldn't tell her that Midnight has a badass battalion of wives, each of them so beautiful, smart, talented, and sweet that they would make any girl or woman who was just as pretty looking as them and not normally the jealous type feel green and a little insecure, causing her to step up her game. Seriously. In fact, when I asked Elijah if he felt jealous that Midnight had three wives, he said, "I have three wives too, Portia, Ivory, and Siri." Then he pointed out the three diamond rings on my finger and my wedding band. "That's 11 carats total, your favorite number," he said. Then I loved him even more. Maybe Winter would see me as a traitor for falling in love with one of Midnight's wives as she galloped at top speed on an Arabian horse across the desert like a beautiful mirage. She rode more better than any native I had come to know and love. She let me ride freely. As I mounted the horse, I imagined I'd race her. Then she mounted her horse after making sure I was fine on mine. Then she left me in her wind and dust. I wouldn't tell Winter none of that. "What about that wife he showed up with at the graveyard?" Winter asked. I felt a ways about her speaking so easily and casually about Mama's burial day, as though anybody else mattered or could be focus of that sad morning. "Did they break up yet?" she poked. "Wait till I get back. I'm gonna grab her spot. That's my spot anyway," Winter said. I laughed nervously. I could see that for Winter, time was standing still. She was frozen, and everyone living on the outside was moving forward and had passed her as they lived into their future. "Hey, what about Buster? At the graveyard, that's who you said was your man. I know he hustles, right? He copped you that big body Benz. When did you meet Elijah? Did you choose him because he had more money? What did Buster do when you dumped his ass? Did he threaten to murder Elijah? Did Buster get at him? Did they fight?" she asked, leaning forward with great interest to my response. "Buster," I repeated unknowingly. Then I was racing back through my mind and through doors that I had slammed closed and locked shut, I thought, forever. Placing myself back in the graveyard where Mama was, my heart cracking, my body aching, I remembered. Busta Rhymes was rhyming when I pulled up into the graveyard. His voice was jumping out of my Bose speakers. That was why I called his name when my big sister asked me about my $150,000 Benz. Winter didn't know how close I was to having a complete nervous breakdown on the day of Mama's burial. That, plus my anger at her and Papa. I could have said or done anything on that day at the graveyard. I wasn't even fearing the armed officers who took aim at me when I pulled up. Somewhere in my mind, I had let go enough not to care if they killed me and tossed me in the box with Mama. Somewhere, somehow, I hoped maybe they would. "It was always only Elijah," was all I said. "My son's name is Elijah Jr.," I murmured, and really, I was speaking to myself now. I was missing my baby and the warm feelings that he gave me. My breast was swollen, hard, and brimming with breast milk. I imagined Elijah Jr. crying out for me. He's a peaceful baby to the whole family, a kind of living love charm, but at night, he's only peaceful if he sees me. If I am not holding him staring into my eyes, lips locked around my nipple, one hand squeezing the other nipple, drawing breast milk like his life depended on it, he would go off. He would be crying a wordless screaming song that I knew meant, I want my mama. Where is my mama? I understood. For 14 years, I felt the same exact way about my mama and sang the same exact song differently. Elijah Senior needed me. Elijah Junior needed me. I needed them just as much, but probably way more. Because of them, I could feel a deeper love inside. I heard you had a fight on the block in Bed-Stuy, nearly blinded a bitch, Winter said. Our cousin, I said. I know she deserved it. I watched how her family flip-flopped on Santiago the second he got locked. That fight was 6 years ago, I said, still used to counting up everything. Who told you about it, I asked. Portia, the whole hood is up in here, minus the niggas, of course. They serve their time elsewhere. Even my girl Natalie is in here. I know you remember her. Yeah, there's nothing that goes on in the Bed-Stuy hood that we don't hear about. Nothing, Winter said proudly. Oh, I said, I couldn't muster up the feeling to care or see the value of keeping up with the aftermath of Papa's empire and reign over Bed-Stuy. Back then, Winter and I both saw, loved, and enjoyed the beauty, the families, the money, the cars, clothes, and jewels. But unlike Winter, I had made it back onto the Bed-Stuy blocks and up into the crack buildings and houses. I saw the ugly. I saw it clearly. Winter, is there anything that you want that you can't get that I could give you? I asked. Not really. She reacted too fast to have considered it. Just then, a teenage girl walked up to our table. The guard signaled her to return to her visit table. Winter signaled the guard as though their roles were reversed. I got her. That's only two at my spot, she called out. You're Portia Emmanuel, right? The 13 or 14 years young girl asked. I knew she already knew. Everybody knew. When Elijah married me, it made headlines, even in places where neither of us had ever stepped foot. 2 weeks after our city hall vows, Vibe magazine placed Elijah on the cover with bold print running over his chest. Young, independent, rich, and married, the headline read. When the more than a million readers flipped those pages, in every flick of Elijah, I was there, his hand holding my hand so tightly, or me partially hidden behind his back, hugging him, or his arm around my shoulders, or neck, or me looking sweet on him, not knowing that I was being photographed, and in an outdoor moment that I instinctively and stupidly thought was private. Then there was also the photo spread of him in the Rolling Stone magazine. Yes, I answered her. Can I get an autograph, and can we take a photo together? Not right now. I'm visiting my sister. I never get to see her, I said, not wanting to hurt her feelings. Her young feelings were hurt anyway. I'm always uncomfortable about giving my autograph. Even as a dancer, on stage, I wanted to amaze people with my movements. After the show, I wanted to be left alone, and I made that happen. I'd stay tucked away in the privacy of my guard dressing room. Now I was completely uncomfortable signing an autograph in front of my big sister. As she walked back to her table, her whole family was looking my way like I was the villain. I felt disgusted inside. Why were strangers always showing more interest in me than my own blood relation showed me? Do you miss me, Winter? Did you ever miss me? I asked her. Do you miss Mama? You must miss Mama. How come you haven't asked about the twins? Did you know they're so smart and pretty, look just like you, and can speak a bunch of different languages? I shot the questions out of a dangerous mixture. Love, passion, anger, and disgust, and maybe even a pinch of hate. What's the sense in asking about them? Whether they doing good or bad right now, I can't do shit about it. I asked you about midnight. You don't seem to want to give up any info. Do you want me to beg you? You know that's not my style, she said calmly, but I could feel the razors in it. I stood up. I'll get midnight to pick you up on your release day. That's something I can do for you, I said. I was in the beginning stages of getting full-blown red. It's good you're leaving, because I was getting bored anyway, what I said. I was going to the ladies' room, not leaving, I said truthfully. But did I need to admit that I need to squeeze milk out of my breast to feel comfortable enough to stay here longer? Well, you might as well keep on going from there. Now, I see why these visits are fucking ridiculous anyway. Ridiculous, I repeated. My body began trembling beneath my Burberry. Winter obviously didn't know what it took for me to come up here, facing my fears and re-entering a prison place, being searched, patted up and down, even my fingertips being drug tested to see if I had handled any drugs in the past 24 hours. She must not have known how many hours Elijah drove to get here, us leaving our house at 4:30 in the morning. She couldn't have known how hard it was for both Elijah Jr.'s parents to leave our newborn at the same time. She must not have known how protected Elijah Jr. from coming into a prison space where even babies are searched, pampers opened, and infant clothes lifted and shuffled around. She don't know how shaken I was leaving my husband in the prison visitation registration receiving building, surrounded by COs who admired him and left their posts to gather around him to get autographs or to hand him demos or to discuss screenplays or books, manuscripts they were thinking about or working on. You're right. She doesn't know, Siri said. How could she know? And Portia, why do you always get upset at someone who doesn't know any better? Give me one second, guys. My headphones are dying here. Okay, I'm coming, guys. All right, I think I got it. Let's see. All right. I appreciate y'all's patience. This after story is longer than I thought, y'all. All right. I feel like dancing. Not in my pretty dance studio that Elijah had built on our family property. I felt like dancing naked inside of a small closet with no windows and very little air until I collapsed. Instead, I came out of my coat and then my heels. I rolled down my tights. Standing barefooted outdoors on the cold cement, I hiked up my Burberry dress and stepped into Elijah's room. I laid my coat, tights, and blonics on his back seat, then turned and placed my feet up on the dash, my toes pressed against the passenger window. He just watched me. I love that he didn't ask me one question about the visit, and for a whole hour, we rode in silence, first narrated by the sounds of coal trains in a sentimental mood, followed by a group of cuts from Papa Jaman's jazz favorites handed down to his younger son. Juxtaposed to who? I asked Elijah without warning 70 minutes later. He smiled, then lowered the volume on the music. That's easy, he said. He still loved Tess. That midnight cat, he said. I couldn't get him to say nothing about anything or to even speak about the whole drug dealing era. He's a type who you gotta watch. A great movie director writer could make millions off of a real life character like him, Elijah said, always excited about film. Ricky Santiaga, the man who built an empire, a man who everybody knew, a name that rings bells in the hood, sounds alarms in the police precincts, and raises respect in the prison system. Ricky Santiaga juxtaposed to his right hand, the silent man who nobody knows. Somehow, the right hand ends up with an empire and an army. He does big business, seemingly, minus the drugs. He even raises Santiago's youngest daughters. In the end, he remains best friends with Santiago, still carries out the duties of a retired right-hand man, which suggests there was no betrayal between them. Now, that's juxtaposition at its finest, Elijah schemed. I smiled at him. Maybe the story gets told by two sisters, juxtaposed to one another, both daughters of the same hustler. One is speaking from her cell, the other from her clandestine treehouse, a secluded location. Clandestine, I repeated softly. I'd ask him about that word later. I hope you know your man pays attention, he said. I know, I said, smiling now. The CD switched. Now Elijah was playing a new song that Siri recorded for him. All of her songs were only for Elijah. She would only sing them to him. But he would bring them to the world to feel. Siri didn't mind, as long as she didn't have to show up. She sang to him because it made him feel good. It made him happy. It made him love her even more. Portia, some people in the press think you married me for my money, he said. Even some of my friends and co-workers had their doubts about you and us. None of them realized I married you for your money. He said it like it was a fact. I slapped his shoulder. I knew that was Elijah, the actor speaking now, the guy who I first met when he was 12. The actor was still a part of him, even though he prefers directing. So I just listened to him as he began setting up the scene. He was about to rescue me, and I love that. Seriously, you fucking inspire me like crazy, like how you put your pretty feet up here. Your painted toenails and pretty dancer's legs inspired me to get through the first hour of this ride home. He was flirting with me. I'm sure you see a lot of pretty girls everywhere you go, Elijah, and they see you too. What did you tell me when you were 11? He asked me. You said, none of them are like you. None of them are the same thing. He asked and answered the question himself. True, but that's not because of being pretty. That's because of what I've been through in my life in a short amount of time, I said. I know everything you went through was rough while you were going through it. But when you look back on it, every true story, every day, month, and year of your life, and all of your feelings is pure gold. That's why I married you for your money. I don't need to hire any writers or researchers. I'll never run out of stories. My first film was about you. Probably my next 10 films will be about you. I could go to dinner with 1,000 women, one by one, business or no business. I'm just checking my rolly, waiting for them to finish up so I can get home to my wife. He laughed. I laughed too. I love the way he could cure me without any drugs, doctors, or hospitals. I fucking love that about him. I know no matter what girl I see, she won't be prettier than you, can't cook as good as you do. She wouldn't love as deeply as you do or feel as good as you feel to me. She wouldn't care for my family as sincerely or have survived and fought as hard as you did. She wouldn't have earned her own first million on her own, then walked down the Brooklyn block, stealing the show in her red Converses and red ball gown. She wouldn't have ever lived on an Indian reservation and shopped at an expensive Brooklyn organic market, even on the same day she was wearing dirty skips and a dingy white t-shirt. She wouldn't have showed up weeks later, Gucci'd up and designer down to her fingernails. No girl would have been able to get me to follow her lead through Brooklyn to any strange places I never took a look at before to find strange ingredients and things I never heard of before she came along. She wouldn't have dropped $20,000 in a box and handed it to me with a homemade carrot cake like it was no big deal. Then disappear for 8 months, return, and never ask about the cash. She wouldn't have crashed into me with her cart so boldly or got me so open in an underground space and then disappeared for 2 more years so I couldn't forget her, didn't want to, and had to work so hard to not lose my fucking mind. And I wouldn't and couldn't have loved anyone else half as much as I love you. My happy tears were spilling now. He was healing me. What other woman would have a best friend like Siri, who's a little bit sweeter and softer than her? Would she let Siri sing me a song that makes my blood boil and allow me to make love to her too? Portia, no one is more fun than you. He wiped my tears. Another woman could have her BA, BS, master's, or her PhD and still couldn't figure out how to be a little money maker like my wife was even before I married her. She would have the degrees, but you're the real genius. Your life, all 17 years of it that you shed so many tears over, is your riches. The adventures of Porsche Santiaga is worth a billion or at least 100,000 bricks of pure gold. Okay, and that is the end of the story. Okay. Okay, let's see. Y'all, there are, if you have the book, there are pictures of a girl that are absolutely beautiful. And I have written to Sister Souljah to ask her who this young lady is. She is positively gorgeous. I haven't received an answer yet, but she's beautiful. She's absolutely beautiful. So, and she gave an acknowledgement. To the maker of all souls, I give my deepest gratitude, loyalty, appreciation, and submission. No one else is worthy of worship. Okay. All right, y'all. So, yeah. That is the end of that. So let me see what y'all gotta say. Thank y'all for being so patient and listening. Good googly moogly. All right, so hey Choco Chips. Welcome, darling. Thank you for being here. Hey, happy all day with your happy all day ass. Oh my goodness. All right. Mother said the stepping is awesome. I can watch all day. Yes, I love it. I love it when they step like that. I have to that's away from YouTube. We'll talk about that. Child, listen, I haven't worn any heels since 1980 something. I know you lying. I figured out that yeah, that's not for me. That's I'm not like that girly girl like that. I will put them on, for like stay out of my business. But I don't wear them outside, like a little, I like listen, a kitten heel, maybe. Not really. I think the highest I have now is maybe 4 inches or something like that. I don't be doing all that mess, child. Listen, no, ma'am. Let me see. Yes, a mother's prayer. Absolutely. God knows how I was. My mother, oh, how I wish, I think is what you're trying to say. My mother was still here. She could guide me through the heartbrokenness that I have experienced in life. Well, you were fortunate. You had a good mother. Yeah, I ain't gonna be able to do it. With mine. I tried to heal her, but she was broken. Broken beyond repair. Maybe she'll get healed. I don't know. Anyway, moving on. Anybody got time for that job? Yes, trust is a magnanimous word and action, but everybody is not deserving of that. Oh, listen, isn't that place like $5,000 a night or something like that? I don't know. Anthony Lester could tell you, honey, more than that. But I don't know, child. Hey, Mimi. Wait, where we at, child? Oh, hey, Kimber. Welcome, darling. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. Welcome, welcome. Mimi said, I have to admit, I didn't keep up with this book like the others, so I'm a little lost and will stay lost. Oh, girl, this book was good. I told y'all it wasn't as exciting as the other books. But I mean, it was still a good book. I told y'all it was still a good book. It just wasn't, it wasn't all of the listen. Everybody loves winter, honey. And so, because of that, most people find this book a little, little less exciting. I'm not gonna say boring. It's a little less exciting. But yeah. So I mean, I'm hoping that everybody, yeah, honey, Elijah, listen. That they gotta love. Unconditional, absolutely beautiful. And yes, mother, please don't panic. I am okay. I am okay. I just forgot to I take my injection, but I'm waiting for my order to come. They had it on back order or whatever happened. So because sometimes that happens, I usually have the subcutaneous pills. Or not subcutaneous, Jesus, the sublingual pills that go under your tongue, or the drops. And I ran out of the tablets that you can put under there, and they dissolve or whatever, and make your hole you dig red or whatever. They taste like candy though, so it's cool. But and the drops do too. It's just a liquefied version, but you place some drops under your tongue. Well, more than some drops, like. A whole plunger full, and you just hold it under there for a few seconds, and then you swallow it on down, and then you get all luscious and lickety, like you want to be. So, and I kept meaning to do it, and I kept saying it, and every time I went to go potty, I would pass by the cabinet where the drops are, and I kept saying, "Oh, okay, remember to take that when you come out of the bathroom." Child, I come out of the bathroom and sit right back down and get right back to whatever the hell I was doing, and not take them. But I'm good. I just have to remember to do that, and sometimes, yeah, that is a trip. So, but that's that. So, yeah. Listen, y'all know Winter was tough. She was in prison, child. Shit, she was trying to keep from getting shanked up, and she was trying not to feel. Because, honey, yeah. That's what that is. That's what she was going through. Oh, your internet was acting up, evil. Okay, y'all. So, oh, you working on some stuff and listening? All right. Okay. Well, welcome, family. I feel the same way about my mother to this very day. Oh, how I miss her. I'm so sorry for your loss, mother. I am. Child, a whole lot of folks don't know no better. So, listen, it is what it is. Yeah, and I think so. I really do. I really do. Oh, you like the book? Good, Choco Chip. I'm glad you liked it. I mean, I did too. Like I said, I like everything she wrote, but a lot of people, some people can't get with Sister Souljah, and that's okay too. She ain't for everybody, but I liked it. So I'm gonna maybe take a week off before I start the next book. Because that's about midnight. So child, I don't think people we'll see. All right, so listen, I have enjoyed this, but it's 9 o'clock. I am going to take a little time and and enjoy my family. Sit outside a little bit. It's hot, but if you let the screens down, then the big old fly aroundy things, listen, these big ass summer bugs are already outside flying around and making noise and landing on people. They are so disrespectful. So I'm gonna let the screens down out on the back. That way, you can still enjoy outside and not get any creepy crawlies on you because they fly and they are no respecter of humans. They don't give a damn. Oh yeah, I'm gonna take a break. I am. I'm gonna chill out. But yeah, they don't give a damn about you sitting out there swatting. So if you let them down, I'm gonna just cool out with the hubster and just cool out a little bit. Well, after the men folk leave. Then, hey, it'll be time to go sleepy night night, 'cause well, in the morning, duty calls, as it always does. So, you guys, thank you, thank you, thank you. I will hug your bonus grandson as soon as he quits geeking out and writing code and being a super geek. So that's what he is. But anyway, I love you guys. I appreciate you guys listening, and thank you guys for being here and listening to me read this. I appreciate you. I hope you enjoyed it as much as I did giving it to you. And somehow that just didn't come out right. God damn it. Anyway, listen, please, y'all, salute your spirit and protect your peace. And I'll see you guys tomorrow. Okay? I'll be back tomorrow. All right. Bye, y'all. Thank you, moderators. Bye, y'all.